Hi, this is Paul Cantrell with East Coast Aero Club in Bedford, Massachusetts. Just some videos already up on YouTube of helicopters doing autorotations, and there have been a few with touchdowns, but I wanted to put one up where we actually talk about what the pilot's doing to make a specific spot when he's autorotating. And I wanted to do it with touchdowns because you can kind of cheat at the bottom when you're doing a power recovery. It's only really when you're touching down that you're really sure that you've made it to the spot in a position to land. And so I've got some videos that I made with a couple of our instructors at East Coast Aero Club that'll demonstrate that. Now, in this one, the pilot flying is the guy in the left seat. He's an experienced instructor. I'm on the right side there. So you'll see sometimes that I appear to be on the controls, but usually that's just I'm either talking to tower or I'm just guarding the controls, but the guy on the left side is doing all the flying. So we came out on this day. It was a 700-foot ceiling, kind of a rainy day. It was IFR. There was nobody else except instrument traffic going on to 29. So we're using the crosswind runway. Had about 5 knots off the left side, which means it was very little coming down the runway to help us. It was essentially calm wind for us, which is the hardest. A little bit of wind really, really helps with the flare. So we came out today, and he's really working. In the section at the end of this tape, you'll see we came out on a really windy day, and it's a lot easier to do touchdowns with no slide when there's a lot of wind. So what we're doing here is we came out to work on his precision to really make an exact spot with minimal slide, nice soft landings. And so you'll see him do a few things here. So you see he's starting to bank the helicopter. So he's doing an S-turn. What he's done is he's figured out that if he just went straight to the spot, he'd end up going past the spot. So by doing an S-turn, he's actually flying a longer distance to get there. And so we end up using up more energy, and that'll shorten the glide up so that we end up where we want to be. And where we want to be is actually on the numbers of 5. Now, on this particular one, you see he went around that little runway light. So instead of going for the numbers, we went for this next line. And you feel us, so we touch down and then we slide. So we're going to try to minimize the slide. You're always going to have maybe a little tiny bit of slide, unless it's like crazy windy. But we want to minimize it. And the reason is if you're landing off airport, which on a real engine failure you typically are, the more you slide, the more the chance is that you're going to catch a skid on something and roll over. So where we've got a higher inertia rotor system in the R44, we can do a more aggressive flare a little higher up and really get that ground speed low and yet still have a nice soft landing. You can't really do that in an R22. If you try to do a flare 15 feet up, you'll get the flare, but then you won't have enough rotor inertia to get a nice soft landing, and so you risk hitting hard. I've seen them done from that high in an R22, but you have to just bottom the collective, and you just go insanely fast towards the ground, and then at the last second you've got to yank the collective. And the problem is the average pilot, he's not going to be able to do that. And even in training, you're going to bang up machines. Something like an R44, on the other hand, very forgiving, lots of inertia. So what we're doing now, you notice he just pitched his nose down. So he had slowed down, and that's another way that we can control our distances. Best glide in an R44 is at 90 knots because it's a very clean helicopter. So by flying anything slower than that, we fly less far. And we can actually bring the speed way back to 20 or even 0 and really, really shorten the glide up. And then before we go into the flare, we have to re-accelerate so we've got enough airspeed for the flare. So playing games with the airspeed, is another way besides doing S-turns that you can control. So here you saw him bring the nose way up. So what he did was he said, oh, I'm close enough into the spot. If I just go the speed I'm at, we'll overshoot. So he brought the nose up to slow down. Now he's just kind of sitting there, and now you see he's starting to lower the nose. That's to get his airspeed back in preparation for the flare. And he's trying to do it so that he ends up right at the right distance going into the flare. Dropping the nose just a little bit more, gain a little bit more speed. You can see we're going about 50 knots at this point, 55. And he overdid it a little bit. You see we're short. Now it looks pretty far on this wide-angle camera, but it's only like 20 feet short. pretty darn close. He's right on center line. So he probably just, he went to a little bit too low of an airspeed or held it just a little bit too long. And that's why we go out and practice this stuff. Now, you can also play with your rotor RPM. If you bring your rotor RPM down to the minimum allowable, which is 90%, that'll help stretch your glide. If you run it up towards the upper red line at 108, you shorten the glide. But it's kind of a fine-tuned control. You can do that maybe to vary your distance by like 50 feet at most. The other two things, you know, that I mentioned, S-turns and airspeed, are much bigger controls. That's probably 10 feet short of the spot, and that's really nice. You know, it's a very nice soft landing with almost no slide at all. Another way that people can shorten the glide is some people kick it out of trim. I know one very, very experienced guy who is just fantastic at doing that. And I don't, because I like having an accurate airspeed indicator. When you kick it out of trim, your airspeed indicator doesn't read correctly anymore. A lot of people use that technique, and if you're just attitude flying, you know, you can maintain an accurate airspeed even without the airspeed indicator, but my choice is I don't like to do it that way. So we got nice flare. Maybe could have held it a couple seconds more to get just a little slower, and you can see we went past the numbers and we're the first half of the next line, so probably about 15-20 feet past the numbers. So, you know, really, really good. So I'm chopping the throttle on them all different distances from the airport, because if we just do the same thing over and over, you know, the learning goes quick. I'm making them work different problems. So you see this one, we're quite far away, and so look at the airspeed indicator's 90, and the horn was going off because he had brought the RPM down to 90, so he stretched the glide. Once he knew he had enough energy, then he could slow back down. And in fact, he purposely went to where he had a little too much, where we're going to overshoot. And that's what you want. You want to always be in a slight overshoot position. And then that way, if you get some wind shear or something, you'll still make your spot. And when you rise, you're not going to have any wind shear. You're going to go a little past. Then you just do a little simple maneuvers at the end just to dump that last little bit of energy. So it's being conservative, because if you just try to make it to the spot and then you get some wind shear, there's nothing you can do. Then you just simply won't make the spot, and that might mean you're going to hit the tree before the field instead of make it into the field. So you want to always be a little conservative. If it's a really windy day, you've got to be a lot conservative, because the glide ratio is going to be worse than you're used to. So that last one, we were really quite far from the airport. This one's kind of a middle distance, so you see he hasn't really had to play much with the airspeed. It looks to me like he's got it at about 60-65. And that's also worth mentioning. So the manufacturer recommends 70 knots for an autorotation, but you have to realize that there's a lot of stuff that varies, that the gross weight of the aircraft, the wind, all kinds of stuff. So, you know, as a student pilot or a low-time pilot, we're going to make you shoot for exactly 70%. But then, you know, when you get experience like this guy is, you realize you've got some latitude. Now, again, like in an R22, very little latitude for the airspeed going into the flare. A little bit based on gross weight, but pretty much, you know, with two people and mid tanks of fuel, you know, 60 knots is great. When you're alone, 55. That's kind of it. 55 to 60 is kind of the sweet spot. Robinson wants you a little faster just for some insurance. 44, on the other hand, much, much bigger range of airspeeds that you can use. I've done, the lowest speed touchdown I've ever done was 45 knots. Now this one, he's just got it nailed. A little bit of slide, maybe 5 feet of slide, but otherwise nice soft land and everything. This final one now, we're going to the grass. We usually go to the pavement. We always go to the pavement with students. And the reason is because the pavement is actually more forgiving. If you touch down yawed, or on heels or toes, the pavement will mask the air. But if you do that on grass, you're going to tip over. So we're doing it here for practice for him, because he might actually have to do a real engine failure and end up off airport. But it's not something that we would typically do with students. Nice flare. He's got the speed real low. Skids are perfectly straight ahead. And watch how fast it stopped, because the grass really grabs the skids when you touch down. All right, so these are on another day. This is just recently, January of 2013. And it was a pretty windy day. It was 22 gusting 37. But again, the guy I'm flying with is an experienced instructor, so we figured we could still go ahead and go out and do it. It makes the autos easier. More wind means you don't need as big of a flare at the end to kill your speed, so you can usually get it stopped with absolutely no slide. But you can see on this first one, he does more of an R22 style approach. So he's coming in. You see he's shallowing it out. He's done kind of a pre-flare. So we've killed our vertical speed. And we're kind of floating along the ground. And now you're seeing the nose comes up a little bit more. He's doing that to kill his forward speed. And then as we approach the ground, he has to level the ship. And see how far we slid? We probably slid like 20, 30 feet. And that's kind of typical of a lower inertia system, that type of an approach. You'll see people on YouTube doing it in 22s all the time. But with the 44, we can do is we can do a higher flare, a much more aggressive flare. With the extra altitude, that means we can stand it up much more nose high and stinger low. But because we're higher up, we're not going to hit the stinger. And that'll really let us kill our speed and get minimal slide. Now, why do we want low slide? On the pavement, it doesn't matter at all. You can slide 1,000 feet. It's not great for the skid shoes, but you know, no problem. But you think about it, most autorotations are going to be off airport. And you can't slide 1,000 feet through Farmer Brown's back 40. You know, you're going to catch a skid on something and flip over. So you want to minimize the slide if you can. Again, R22, I generally will just take some slide, because otherwise in training we'll be beating the machines up. But an R44 or a Jet Ranger or an Enstrom, you got that inertia. You can really use it to do a more aggressive flare and really, really get that nice short slide that'll work off airport. So I'm telling, you can hear me telling him, he was a little high because we did a higher flare, but the RPM was hanging up there at 106, so he had plenty of rotor RPM for a nice high hovering auto. R44 with two people on board, you know, mid fuel, you can easily do a 25-foot hovering auto at the end of an auto rotation. Not a hovering auto from power on. But when we're doing touchdown auto rotations, if you get that nice build of RPM right up to 106, 107%, you can be pretty high up, and you'll still have enough rotor inertia for a nice soft landing. Talk a little bit about what he's doing here. So we're almost over the numbers when I killed the engine on him. So what he's done is he's brought the airspeed back to zero. We got a 40 knot headwind, so it's actually blown us backwards. So you can see now we can actually see the numbers that we were over. So he's waited while we descended, actually going backwards, and now he's re-accelerating so that we can get enough speed for the flare. And you hear me telling him, rock the wings just to drop a little bit more of our ground track, just shorten it up a little bit. And so we're heading for the numbers. You can see me counting down to help him judge the flare. Nice flare. And look at you can see there's absolutely no ground run at all, and he made it right to his spot, and he's exactly on center line. And we're going to just do one more just like that one. You're going to see a nice flare, high enough up with enough flare that by the time we touch down, there'll be just absolutely no ground run at all, and we're going to be right on center line, right on the spot we're trying to make the numbers 2-3. So I hope you enjoyed watching these, and if you live around the Boston area, you want to come fly with us, give us a shout anytime. Love to have you.